Welcome to Tina's Wish Cocktail Party. My name is Marian Cheng. I am one of the co-founders of Mimi Cheng's Dumplings in New York City, and I am so excited to be your MC tonight.
Hey, Mar.
Hi.
Hey, guys. My name is Kat Odell. I am a food and travel journalist and also the author of two books, a cocktail book based on low ABV cocktails called Day Drinking, and also a plant-based cookbook inspired by Ayurveda and other medicinal cuisines from around the world called Unicorn Food. Just wanted to say a quick thank you to everyone for tuning in tonight, and especially to Tina's Wish Junior Advisory Board and NextGen Committee for organizing this awesome event. And just one thing I wanted to mention, please make sure you guys are in speaker view, not gallery view, and you can just click the button in the top right corner of your screen to switch over.
Yeah, awesome. So before we get started, I wanted to talk about the cause behind this evening of our cocktail party. So the mission of Tina's Wish is to fund groundbreaking research for the early detection of ovarian cancer and to ultimately give women and their families the fighting chance they deserve against this disease. Did you know that ovarian cancer is the number one deadliest gynecologic cancer? Unlike other diseases for which there is an early detection test like the pap smear and mammogram, there's no such diagnostic tools that exist for ovarian cancer. So most women that are diagnosed in advanced stages, they have only a 27% survival rate. So an early detection test would dramatically change these statistics, and that is the Tina's Wish goal. So the foundation annually funds $1.6 million in research grants to leading institutions, and three of their projects have clinical trials on the horizon.
So guys, please consider voting during this program. Just visit tinaswish.org/donate or simply click the link you see in the chat box. We'll continue to post it in the chat box throughout the event. And for anyone who donates $5 or more during the event, you'll have the chance to win a gift certificate to Mare's super amazing restaurant, which specializes in Taiwanese dumplings, one of my favorites, Mimi Cheng's, or a copy of my book, Day Drinking. And if you guys have any questions throughout the event, please feel free to ask. Just type them into the chat box and I will answer.
Awesome. So before we get started and learning from Kat, let's do a short, fun icebreaker with a few polls. So questions are going to pop up and then we'll see what the community says. Okay, so the first one is, what's the strangest thing you've done while attending a Zoom meeting? Multiple choice, okay. What is your go-to summer drink? They all sound amazing, and I think all of them. Okay, amazing. And then, since being in quarantine, how early has your happy hour gotten? Wow, I'm surprised that there isn't an earlier time than what the answers currently have. All right, so the results are coming in. Let's see. I've definitely done all of these. Don't you agree? All right, we have a few more seconds before we announce the answers.
I know aperitivo hour in my house has been getting like started early and earlier every day.
I mean, I completely agree with you.
100%.
Okay, let's see. All right, so I'll be curious to see if you guys agree with this, but okay, the strangest thing you've done while attending a Zoom meeting is cook lunch/dinner. Yep, everyone's hungry all the time. What is your go-to summer drink? Rosé is the answer. Okay.
Strong.
Yeah. And then, since being in quarantine, how early is a happy hour gotten? I'm on the it's 5 o'clock somewhere mentality. Okay, that was our answer, Kat, that we were looking for.
Definitely. Slash like maybe even earlier.
Yeah.
Probably earlier for me.
Exactly. Okay, so now I'm gonna turn it over to Kat and we're gonna get started on the first cocktail.
Cool, so the first drink I'm gonna make is a mezcal cocktail. I actually spent the last 5 months living in Mexico, in Tulum. I only got back to the US like 3 weeks ago. So I've always loved mezcal. Mare and I took a trip to Oaxaca for 4 or 5 years ago now together to explore all the palenques. anyway, mezcal is a favorite spirit of mine, and that's the base of this cocktail. This cocktail could also be made with tequila if you prefer tequila, but I'm a big mezcal fan. It also incorporates passion fruit, one of my favorite ingredients in the world. We have lime, cilantro for a little bit of freshness and to give it a little bit of a twist. Now, jalapeno for spice. Oh, and just gonna pimp out a product I launched really quickly. If you don't have, this is just like a good pro tip in general. If you wanna make a spicy cocktail and you don't have a pepper, a spicy pepper at home, hey, add hot sauce, right? Why not? This is a product that I'm launching in about 2 weeks. It's pre-sale right now with my fiance and our business partner, Yannick, who has an amazing single varietal California olive oil company. It's called Hot Slop. You can find it online. And it's flavored with miso.
I can't really see it.
Ah!
There we go.
Like this. Oh. So it has CBD in it. We have a THC version coming out, but CBD, and it is made with miso and umeboshi. So it's kind of like Japanese influenced. Anyway, hot sauce. But so this is going to be a spicy cocktail. So passion fruit, lime, jalapeno. I'm going to add, this is agave nectar, not to be confused with agave syrup. I'm really conscious about not making drinks. Well, not really eating refined sugar, period. And when I make cocktails, I never use simple syrup. I often use honey. I use something called yucum syrup, which is amazing. And today, because we are making an agave-based cocktail, I thought that agave to agave would make a lot of sense. Make sure, though, when you buy agave nectar, not syrup, there's a difference between the two. I think the terms are often used interchangeably. So agave nectar is unprocessed. Meanwhile, agave syrup is super processed, which means during the production process, a lot of the nutrients are taken out. So always look for nectar. And this, for example, I got this at Whole Foods. It doesn't say agave nectar, but all you have to do is flip it over, read the ingredients, and you'll see agave nectar.
Okay.
Also, look for a darker color. Darker color means less refined. So agave nectar, cilantro, and then this is salt. I love adding salt to cocktails. Just a bit. And it's not going to make the cocktail taste salty, but it'll give it an extra pop. So what you need for this is a cocktail shaker and a muddler. So depending on how cilantro-y you like things, and cilantro I know can be quite a polarizing flavor, so you can definitely make this without cilantro. Also, just a note on passion fruit, by the way, I'm gonna add, this is like 3 sprigs of cilantro, just drop that in. No ice, nothing in here yet. So just a note on passion fruit. If you can find fresh passion fruit, get it. Once in a while, I see it at Whole Foods, but if you can't, you can go online and buy. Like, for example, I went online the other day on Amazon and found this, and it's all it is passion fruit juice, and it's delicious. It tastes exactly like the real thing. I was really impressed, actually. I didn't expect it to be that good. It's awesome. It's like $12 for this. Otherwise, sometimes you can find passion fruit juice in stores. However, oftentimes those have added sugar, which would throw off a little bit of the balance in here. So if you use a sweetened juice, I would say cut back on the on your sweetener. And if you can't find passion fruit, you could add mango. Think about it in terms of what does passion fruit offer to the cocktail. It's a high acid fruit. So you could also even do like a 50-50, a fresh orange juice to fresh grapefruit juice. And the last thing that I do want to note is that please, whenever you make cocktails, use fresh fruit. You know, like juice your limes, juice your lemons. Please don't buy anything like those little green and yellow, like lime lemon shaped plastic cans, containers that you can buy at the supermarket. They taste horrible and they will ruin your cocktail. Please just get some fresh fruit. All right, so we have our cilantro in here. Now I'm gonna measure 1.5 ounces of this passion fruit juice. And if you're using actual fresh passion fruit, you can do the same. So that is 1.5 ounces. And then over here, I already, this is like from an hour ago, I just juiced some lime. So this is 1.5 ounces of fresh lime juice, which is gonna go into our cocktail. We are going to add a half ounce of agave syrup. Also, something I should share with you is that You know, when you make a recipe, not even specific to cocktails, just cooking in general, a recipe is somebody's idea of ingredients that taste good together. And the same holds true for cocktails. So what I mean by that is you can always adapt and change that. Baking is a little bit more of a science, but for the most part with savory cooking, you know, you can play around with recipes to fit your own palate. And for me, when I make cocktails, I don't like sweet drinks. I'm very sensitive to high sugar drinks, which is unfortunately what I feel like I encounter all the time. So the drinks that I'm showing you today are very low in sugar. So you can adapt. If you want something a little bit sweeter, please feel free to add a little bit more sweetener. But I go on the more
part.
So
what about the cilantro part for people who don't necessarily like cilantro?
Totally. Yeah. So you could definitely make this cocktail and just completely omit the cilantro.
Okay.
No big deal. Like totally cool. Also I have jalapeno over here just because it's a pretty user-friendly pepper. It's not crazy hot, but you could use other hot peppers. I'm going to add about 3 rings that are this kind of, let's say, 3 millimeters, and that will give it a slight heat, but it won't be super hot. I actually tend to like drinks kind of spicy, but habanero would also be fun, which is my favorite pepper, amazing flavor, but you would want to go pretty lightly on that. Anyway, so now we're gonna get to our mezcal. This is a new brand that just came out that I really like. So typically when you're making a cocktail, you would not want to use one of the rare or wild agave varietals. This is cenizo. Typically what you would use is espadín. That's the most commonly available mezcal varietal. This is just, I'm not at home right now. I'm in Savannah, Georgia. So this is just happens to be what I have here, which is why I'm using this. But for anyone else that's going to go out and buy spirits or that wants to make mezcal cocktails, you should definitely don't get anything too fancy because you're not going to taste the flavor of the plant in your drink. It's going to be muddled with all the other, you know, the other flavors that you're putting into the cocktail. And a lot of those like really expensive mezcals like tepaxtate, jabalí, those are all meant to be sipped neat. You know, you're not adulterating those. Okay. And finally, salt. This is really adding a pinch of salt to cocktails as subtle and simple as it seems really makes a difference. Again, just a tiny pinch. So now we are going to take our muddler. Muddlers you can find online, really easy to find. And the idea being now is to sort of incorporate all of those flavors together. I want to break up the cilantro and I also want to break up the peppers to release all of their flavors. And so that'll mingle with the mezcal and the passion fruit and the lime and kind of, you know, make everyone nice and happy and well incorporated. So after the muddling, I'm going to grab some ice I have here in the sink. You can fill your shaker up with fill it halfway with ice. And then we're going to do the shaking. However, before I shake, I have a cocktail glass right here. I love big cubes, big rocks. So I have some big rocks here. They're not as beautiful and crystal clear as you'll get at a cocktail bar, but they will suffice. And the idea being with these large cubes is that large cubes dilute at a slower rate, which means your drink is not as watered down and it stays colder longer. So that's kind of like the idea with these big cubes.
You were reading my mind answering that question.
Sorry, can't hear you there.
Oh, I said you were reading my mind answering that question.
Boom.
So what's the difference between tequila and mezcal?
Thank you for asking. So tequila and mezcal, they both come from agave, the plant. So tequila comes from one very specific type of agave called Blue Weber. It's a plant. And mezcal comes from many different. For example, I just use cenizo. There's espadín. There's many, many different types of plants that are used for mezcal production. However, a big difference also is the way the spirits are made. So you have these like large plants, these agaves that are growing in a field. They're huge. They're really heavy. So when they're harvested, by the way, so cenizo grows 9 to 13 years roughly before it's harvested, but there's some really pricey mezcals that sometimes grow up to 30 years. And that's also partially why some mezcal is so expensive. Because like, think about that. A plant can't be harvested for 30 years, right? That's a really long time. So also the way the plant is, roasted underground. So when you try mezcals, you get this smoky flavor. So what happens is after the plants are harvested, the spikes are cut off, and you have what's called a piña that's left over. Workers then cut that up. It's thrown into a pit with lava rocks, and then it's actually smoked underground, which is where you get the smoky flavor from the mezcal. Whereas when you're producing tequila, you basically take the piñas, roast it in an oven, it caramelizes. It actually tastes amazing. I tried that, like the roasted piña when I was once in tequila a few years ago. The flavor is incredible. It's like burnt sugar. Anyway, so then it's distilled after that. And typically with mezcal, you want to drink mezcal while it's young. And tequilas, as I'm sure a lot of people know, can be aged for a really long time.
Okay.
Awesome. Anyway, so here's our first cocktail. I tend to go really simple with garnishes, like nothing too crazy, but I don't know if you can kind of see that right over here. Kind of vibe.
How spicy.
And I will also promote this company, which is called Kimura Glass. Huh. It is a Japanese company, and their glassware, there is no other glassware in the world as incredibly beautiful and expensive, but incredibly beautiful as this company. The glasses are, you know, paper thin lips. They're just incredible to drink from. Check that company out.
All right.
Cocktail one.
Sounds great. And you said that you lived in Mexico for a while.
So I was living in Mexico until the very end of May.
Okay.
Got back to the US last month. And it was a great experience. I mean, Mexico is amazing, but definitely happy to be back in the US.
Yeah, definitely. But an abundance of passion fruit over there, whereas it's...
That's actually very true. There was so much passion fruit.
Yes, but at least you found a great version from Amazon, you said?
Yeah. So I love this. Frankly, this is the best version that I've found. Find this on Amazon. It's called Wana Banana. I think they make some other fruit as well, but it's inexpensive and the flavor is delicious and it tastes exactly like fresh passion fruit and there's no additives. So many of these types of companies like put preservatives and artificial flavors and color, it has nothing, none of that.
Got it. All right, we're gonna take some questions. So what can you use if you don't have a muddler?
Great question. So things that I've done, I've used like a large wooden cooking spoon. I've used like a fork. It's not as easy. Pretty much anything you can find that has a little bit of like a larger, either like a stirring part or even just a handle that you can flip over and do this. You know, I've even used the back of like a knife before. So not saying to hold it like that, of course, but I've used like a knife that's not as sharp and use like a dinner butter knife kind of, and use the bottom part of it for muddling.
Yeah.
So you're kind of just looking for anything in your kitchen that might have a shape like this.
Awesome. All right. So before we move on to the next drink, let's do a 1 minute cheers to music. So if you don't have your video on already, please go ahead and turn that on. So we can do a kiss cam style and pick at random some of you to cheer, say hi, or dance. So let's see your best shots.
Fill up my cup, mazel tov. Look at her dancing, just take it off. Let's paint the town, we'll shut it down. Let's burn the roof,
and then we'll do it again.
Let's do it, let's do it, let's do it, let's do it. And do it, and do it,
let's live it up.
And do it, and do it, and do it, do it, do it. Let's do it, let's do it, let's do it. Cause I got a feeling, that tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night.
That was so fun. It was really great to see some of your faces. And I just wanted to mention, if you don't already, please go ahead and follow Tina's Wish on their social media platforms, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and LinkedIn. They are at Tina's Wish. It's a great way to show your support and share their mission. So, wow, I have been told we already raised $2,137 through generous donations before and during the event. So thank you all for that. Let's keep it up. Visit tinaswish.org/donate to enter and also donate. So the raffle is still going on for Kat's book and a $50 gift card to Mimi Cheng's. Just think of all the women in your life and all the women all over the world who would benefit from this amazing research. All right, Kat, you ready for number two?
Yeah, let's do it. So drink number two is inspired by Japan. As a food writer, I travel very often and I cover food globally, but my focus is on the country of Japan, on the cuisine, on the drinks, and the cocktail culture in Japan is incredibly, incredibly special. There's nowhere else in the world that has such a beautiful, artful, ingredient-focused cocktail culture at all. And this drink that I'm going to make for you is inspired by one of my favorite bars, which is in just south of Ginza. Ginza is sort of like the hub of a lot of the cocktail culture that exists in Japan. Of course, you'll find bars everywhere, but there's essentially two camps of bars. There's bars that focus on classic style cocktails, and then you have a slightly more fruit-driven approach. Now, this exists for a couple reasons. One, the fruit in Japan is amazing. I was telling Mare before that on my last trip, which was in September, I spent $70 on a bunch of grapes, ate it on the plane home, which I know sounds ridiculous, but when you try those grapes, it will change your life. I am not joking. Also, the square, melons that you see, there's a reason why that fruit has that price tag. It's like eating candy. And when you finish a meal with a piece of fruit like that, one, two bites, you don't need anything else. And there are some bars in Tokyo and elsewhere in Japan that make cocktails with that really exquisite, incredible fruit. And that's why cocktails are very expensive in Japan. So I'm gonna make you a version of that. Just to touch upon the other style of bartending, cocktail culture in Japan is extremely different from the US. In the US, people, are kind of loud and rowdy and there's loud music and people go out in groups or by themselves, they want to chat and socialize. It is not like that in Japan at all. So you will often go to a bar, your bartender is wearing a perfectly pressed white suit, sometimes white gloves. There's jazz playing in the background and everyone sits one by one and it's silent. There's no talking. You are having this experience one-on-one with the bartender. Also, typically what they do is there's this beautiful, artful dance that goes into cocktail making. So a bartender will place every ingredient. I did a really bad sloppy job, sorry, of doing this, but he will take, your ingredients, place everything precisely in front of you. So you can see it starts like this. And then he takes, a cocktail shaker. And then he does, it's really, you have to see it for yourself to understand it. And there are some bars, like if you're in New York, Uchu did it with their Kaiseki bar. Unfortunately, COVID closed, but when they reopen, they're going to be doing a cool cocktail thing. I would say check that out. There are a couple places in New York that you can find that experience, but you've got to go to Japan for it. I mean, it's friggin' awesome. So anyway, I'm, as I mentioned, in Savannah, Georgia right now, and I figured if I'm going to make a seasonal fruit cocktail, it should be with peaches, right? Georgia peaches.
Yes.
So the bar that I mentioned before, it's called Land Bar Artisan, and the owner is this guy, Daisuke Ito, lovely human, and this bar is legitimately the size of a closet. It is, Mare has been there.
Yeah, you recommended it. I can definitely attest that it is a shoebox size, but.
It is, we're not exaggerating. But that is also part of the culture in Japan, restaurants as well, restaurants and bars, they're tiny. A large restaurant in Japan is 30 seats. A lot of the top, sushi places, they're 8 seats. That's it. And that's also why a lot of places are really hard to book the really, really top spots because they have so few seats available. Think about that. You have an 8-seat sushi bar and guess what? You can feed, let's say you do 2 seatings, dinner only, you know, what, 16 guests a night? And cocktail bars usually also, it's typical to have 8 seats. So Daisuke is all about, you know, the beautiful, pristine seasonal fruit that I mentioned before. So you walk into his bar, which, by the way, has no bathroom, so figure that out before you come. And he has this, like, beautiful wall of spirits, and he has usually 3 pieces of seasonal fruit. So it could be a tomato, it could be peaches, it could be strawberries, it could be a melon. So you pick your fruit and you pick your spirit, and then he makes you this, like, incredible, beautiful cocktail. And the point being is that you don't need a lot of ingredients to make a delicious cocktail. What you do need is really, really ripe ingredients. You know, pick what is the best in the region that you are in, which is why I'm picking peaches. I think for some of the country, peach season is still maybe like a month or so out. Right now we have some really nice peaches. Also, you want really juicy fruit. So I bought these peaches last week, and I kind of let them sit out to get really, really extra soft, which is great for cocktail making. And so what I'm going to be doing is, it's essentially a seasonal gin and tonic with peach. So you could do this drink. I've had this drink made with strawberry, with persimmon. So you can use a lot of different fruit. I'm just, as I said, picking peach because I think it makes sense for where I am. But also strawberries are in season right now on the East Coast. So strawberry could be a fun option, a fun fruit addition. So half a peach. I have a pretty big peach, so let's say half a large peach. You want to put that in your cocktail shaker. We're not going to shake it, but we are going to muddle it. And then I like gin. You could, bourbon and peach would be great. I'm doing gin. So this is going to be half a peach to 1.5 ounces of gin. This is Japanese gin. I'm a unsurprisingly, a big fan of Japanese spirits. This is Roku, and the botanicals in this are pretty cool. It has sakura leaf, which has like a kind of cherry almond flavor. It has yuzu. It has sancho, which is a type of pepper that's delicious. So it's uniquely floral. It's not your typical like London Dry with juniper. It's a little bit different. Now, I'm not going to add salt to this cocktail. I don't think it necessarily needs it. It's a slightly different sort of vibe to the mezcal margarita we made. So now we have spirit in here. We have half a peach, ripe peach, and you want to muddle. So actually one thing I should mention is when you make drinks like this, there's a couple of different ways to make them. This is the most laborious way, by muddling. But when you sit down at Lambar Artisan, the way Daisuke makes his drinks is he takes like a plastic deli container like this. He puts the spirit in and he puts the fruit in, and he takes a hand blender and he blends it all. And then after blending, he takes, you know, his glass and he pours it through a strainer like this, which is what I'm gonna do. But I don't have a hand blender because I'm not at home. Another hack that I've done when I am at home is take like a, you know, like a Vitamix, a blender, put your fruit and spirit in the blender, and then pass it through the strainer in the same way. But I'm, not at home without any equipment. So I'm doing it by hand, and you can definitely do it by hand. It definitely works. Okay. And again, I've had versions of this drink with apple. Like the idea being you want a juicy fruit. So like banana, maybe not banana. all right, so now this is like really nice and sort of juicy. Oh, I did forget one ingredient. This is actually not necessary. Back on the subject of sweeteners, so I'm gonna add agave again. I'm only adding 1/4 ounce, which is like almost nothing. It's very, very little. And depending on how sweet your fruit is, you actually don't need to add any sweetener. I mean, 1/4 ounce is very, very small. It's just a touch. But that's the thing. It's like, you know, when you're making fruit cocktails, you always wanna make the drink based around balance. So that's really important. And to understand the balance of the drink, you know, your strawberries in December versus June are going to be very different. They're not going to be as ripe, right? They're going to be like, oh, the Driscoll's with no flavor versus like the Hamptons berries that are just like the most amazing thing ever. Anyway, so adjust your sweetness based on how sweet your fruit is or isn't. So now that I have this, I have, we put a touch of agave, we have the peach, and we have the gin. Now, I am going to do exactly what I just said. First,
how much did you say of the spirit you put in?
So I put in 1.5 ounces.
Okay.
It is actually quite common in Japan to have low ABV drinks. This like American culture of like very boozy alcohol forward is not super ubiquitous in Japan. Again, it's like all about the balance of the drink is what's really important to bartenders there. That being said, you know, if you're going to a whiskey bar, I'm a huge Japanese whiskey fan, you're drinking also straight spirit, but that's kind of like a different animal. So this has 1.5 ounces, but like Daisuke sometimes I believe only puts, you know, like an ounce in. If you go to a place like Gen Yamamoto, which is an amazing experience, his drinks I would say have only, you know, 1/2 ounce of alcohol, but you're going through like an omakase cocktail tasting menu. It's incredible an experience. You can have 5 or 7 cocktails. They're tiny little cocktails, you know? And sometimes it's just like a little bit of sake, but it's really, really awesome. All right, so now this is the same process. So whether you're using a hand blender, Vitamix, or what I just did, you're gonna pretty much have now do the same thing, which is to strain your liquid. And it's a little bit pulpy, like that. So I suggest taking the back of a spoon and kind of helping your liquid drip in. Just kind of get all that juice into your glass. And then you can kind of like switch it out. I have a sink over here and keep going, do that another time, just like this. And right now you have a mixture of fresh, sweet peach juice and you have the gin, right? And just a touch of sweetener. So if you see, it's not all that much, but the flavor is really concentrated. It's just kind of, you know, maybe 1.5 to 2 ounces at the bottom of your glass. And you can use, this is just a glass that I happen to have at home, but you can use like a Collins glass. I like to do these typically in slightly taller glasses. Finally, we're gonna add some tonic water. I really like Fever Tree as a brand. I think that the flavor of the tonic is really lovely. Sometimes tonic can be, in my opinion, sort of syrupy and a little bit cloying and has this sort of like sharp, bitter flavor. I think Fever Tree does a really great job of creating a much more nuanced and complex beverage, so that's typically what I like, and it's also what a lot of the bartenders in Japan use as well. So then after this, you're just gonna top your drink with about 1/2 a bottle, a little bit less, just like this. And finally, gonna give it a quick little mix, and this is your seasonal peach gin and tonic.
Amazing. That looks so great.
And so, it's super floral. I mean, you can smell the sweetness in the fruit. I love this drink.
I can't wait to make that once I get my hand on some peaches.
I know, right? Soon.
Definitely. Okay, we have a question. So cool. What pairings would you suggest with both of the drinks that you made this evening?
Sure. So depending if you want to go sweet or savory, I would actually potentially do some charcuterie. I feel like maybe some ham could be really good. Different types of like chorizo with the mezcal cocktail. Also like anything kind of like snacky and salty is really good. Like pretzels, you know, kind of salty to balance the sort of juiciness in the drink. And then with the mezcal cocktail, actually it's customary in Mexico when you order mezcal, there's a certain way it's often served. You usually get this like wooden or clay board, and it has slices of orange, and sometimes the orange is garnished with worm salt, which sounds probably not that appetizing, but it's actually very delicious. So serving this with like a little bit of fruit on the side could be nice. Hey, chips and guac, right? Like, why not? But no, tortilla chips, like anything corn-based would be really good. Think about Mexican food, like, that's a very Mexican drink and it has Mexican ingredients. So in terms of pairing, think about flavors that you'd find in Mexico, and it'll work quite nicely.
Amazing. Okay, one last question before we run out of time. So you mentioned the small intimate bars in Japan, or rather Tokyo. Are there bigger, larger, more rambunctious bars?
I mean, Yes, there are. I seek out a very specific type of bar, which is generally cocktail driven or spirit driven, just because I love Japanese whiskey and I'm so inspired by Japanese bartending. So that's what I tend to go to. And they are, as I mentioned, really small. It's usually like a long bar. And then sometimes it's just a bar. And then sometimes there might be a small, like four kind of two tops or sort of loungy, low slung tables. I have been to a whiskey bar in Shibuya that was actually by Japanese standards really, really big. I think it's just called the Whiskey Library actually. And that probably has like 150 seats, but that's huge for Japan. That's the only bar I've ever been to that's that size. I'm sure there's like larger places. The one place that I do really love that's new in like the last year, a friend of mine, Shingo Gokan, who's also designed a bunch of cocktail lists for different bars in New York and who will be opening another bar secret with a friend of mine, maybe in a year or so. But he already has two bars on World's 50 Best in Shanghai. And he just last year opened his first bar in Tokyo. It's called the SG Club. It's friggin' awesome. So he melds American craft cocktails with more of a Japanese sensibility and Japanese ingredients. So you find a lot of like savory cocktails with like dashi, umami driven cocktails. So it's called the SG Club. S stands for sip and then G stands for guzzle. So the top is more, you know, sort of like sippable cocktails while the bottom is like guzzle, poundable cocktails. But that's a really awesome spot. It is bigger than, and it's more of a kind of like a going out place, I would say. It's really awesome. Definitely recommend that.
Okay, we are almost out of time, but just remind everyone what brand of gin, of Japanese gin you're using again.
Totally. So this is Roku. Okay. Big fan. I also really like Nika has a gin that has a green label. Just Google Nika gin. It is phenomenal as well. The botanicals are really, really aromatic. It's wonderful. So yeah, Japanese gin is incredible. It's Japanese whiskey is a little bit more known and gin is slowly now becoming more known, but Japanese gins, also the Kyoto distillery makes an amazing gin that's distilled from rice. That is awesome.
That's so great. I think after international restrictions pass, we all need to go to Tokyo and
everyone.
Explore.
All the people. Everyone needs to go, I promise. It's life-changing to go there.
Yeah, so we are out of time now, but I just wanted to say how amazing it is that we are at $2,780. So help us reach $3,000 by tomorrow morning. And just wanted to do a last cheers. So hold up your drink, please. Cheers to someone or something in the chat box. My cheers is to Kat. Thank you for sharing your cocktail making skills and knowledge of Japanese culture. And thank you all for joining us tonight, especially to those who donated to this important mission to give women worldwide a fighting chance against this ovarian cancer. And lastly, it's still not too late to donate and enter the raffle. So do so before midnight tonight at tiniaswish.org/donate. And they will announce by noon tomorrow on Instagram and Facebook Live. Thank you. Okay. Have a great night, everyone.